Well, good morning, Harvest. Happy Mother's Day. It's so good to be gathered here together on this great day. I'm going to read out of Psalm 96. It says this: O nations of the world, recognize the Lord. Recognize that the Lord is glorious and strong. Give to the Lord the glory that he deserves. Bring your offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in all his holy splendor. Let all the earth tremble before him and tell the nations that the Lord reigns. Church, it's so good to be gathered together, isn't it? So this morning, can we just bring our worship to him? Can we bring our praise to God this morning? Sing this with me.
Praise to the Lord, to the Lamb, to the King of heaven. Praise, for he rose, now he reigns. We will sing forever. Praise,
come on,
to the Lord.
King of heaven,
oh, praise, for he rose,
now he reigns.
sovereign. Praise to you. And come on. Oh, you sound good. Woo! Come on.
Praise to you, sovereign.
Just like Lazarus, oh, you brought me back to life. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful. name. What a beautiful name. The name that is above every name. To where every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. There's no name higher than your name, Lord. And we worship you because of your name, because of what you've done. May we never get tired of saying the name Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. God, we thank you for who you are and what you've done for us. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Harvest, go ahead and take a seat. My name is Ramirez Moody, and I serve as the campus pastor at our Rolling Meadows campus. And I'm being joined today by this beautiful lady, my wife, Kathleen. Happy Mother's Day. Yeah. And happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers in the room. It's so great to not only be here to worship on God's Day, but to also take a pause and just be reminded of what our mothers do for us. And if this is your first time joining us today, I want to extend a very special welcome to you. And just know that you're amongst a welcoming people. I'm one of them. And I'm going to be in the lobby at the end of service. I'd love the opportunity to meet you. I'll be in the welcome section. And I'd love to just see how I could serve you during your time here at Harvest. And Harvest, in our continuing efforts to connect with you and to care for you, we have this thing called the Harvest Bible Chapel app. And if you don't have the app, you can scan the QR code on the seat in front of you. But this allows us to just care for you through prayer. Also, it allows you to get connected here into community if you would like to do that. You can do that all through the Harvest Bible Chapel app.
And I want to give a special happy Mother's Day to all of the women in the room here today. We're so happy to have you with us. And we're honoring the women of our church, the mothers in our church and in our lives. We honor them not because of their perfection, but because we recognize the unique calling they have on our lives. So if you're a mother, a stepmother, a grandmother, adopted mother, or birth mother, would you please stand? I would like to invite everyone to join me. Pray a blessing over them today. Have you close your eyes and bow your heads. Father, on behalf of the mothers in this room, with gratitude for the work that is set before them, we thank you. Thank you for the selflessness that is motherhood, for the hours of care, for the sacrifice of time and freedom, for the wisdom and guidance that they provide, for their patience and prayer when children lose their way. Father, thank you for the way that women represent you and how they are made in your image. By being a mother, they bring qualities of your character and nature into their homes and into the hearts of their children. Thank you that by representing you, you have entrusted mothers to be strong disciple makers of the generations to come. Father, would you give them the courage to mother well? Give them the strength to endure the hours ahead. For mothers with little ones, give your daily bread and give them rest. For mothers in the growing in between years, patience and earnestness in prayer. And for mothers of adult children, would you bless them with the fruit of relationship? Father, we also lift up those who are childless, for those who have not yet come into that season, and for those who have lost children and have not known children of their own. We pray that you, God of comfort, would heal in ways only you can. Just like your peace surpasses all understanding, would your healing come in ways that surpass our understanding? For those who mother alone, would you be an ever-present help? You are the God who sees every need. You are a father to the fatherless and a comfort to the lonely. Be near, Father. For those with broken relationships with their own mothers, would you restore what's broken and mend the hurt? Help us to forgive as you have forgiven us. Help us to learn from the brokenness to bring health to generations after us. Lastly, Father, we ask for freedom from perfectionism and comparison. Help mothers as they grace their children. Would they allow your grace to cover them, knowing that you are in control, that you are writing the story. Help them to see the joy that they get to participate in the work you are doing in their lives. Today and every day, we honor and cherish the mothers who have nurtured and cared for us. Would our hearts overflow with gratitude to you who formed us in our mother's womb. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you, mothers. Thank you for caring for us in a way that only you can. In 1 Timothy chapter 6 and 18, it says this: they are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share. As we grow in our relationship with the Lord, our worship becomes greater. Would you agree? Like, as you begin to know the Lord and know what he has for us, it draws us closer to him in our worship and in our walk, and also in the way that we give. God has called us to be a generous people. And so we now have an opportunity to worship the Lord through our giving in the ways that you know that you can give here at Harvest Bible Chapel. You'll see it on the screen here. But before we open up God's word, let's just pray for this week's offering. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to get wealth. And so now we have an opportunity to give a portion of that back to you. Lord, it is our prayer that it is pleasing in your sight. May it continue to provide the needs of our church. And we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. All right, Harvest, grab your Bibles and turn them to 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 13 through
25. How are you? It's good. It's good to see you or be seen by you or whatever. It's great. You need a Bible, and you need to turn it to 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 13 to 25, as Ramirez just said a minute ago. But one of my most embarrassing Christian moments was actually when I was a new believer. Kind of came to faith in Christ at a Christian camp, and kind of off and on Christian relationship, because you know, camp would be a week every summer, and I didn't really go to a great church and all that, so I'd always get pumped up in camp and then come back and it would fade away and then get pumped up in camp, that kind of thing. And anyway, finally, there was a point at which I was like, okay, they're going to make this Christian stuff my own, you know. I think I was first year in high school or something like that, and I was sitting across from a girl who I just met, and she and her friend were there, and we were supposed to be doing this project in our English class, and she said, so we were getting to know each other, and I said, tell me about yourself, and she said, I'm a druidic pagan. And I said, first of all, I said, what in the world is a druidic pagan? And then she talked about Stonehenge, you know, in England. And I was like, never been there. And, you know, as a new Christian, all that's rolling through my head is like, well, you're, like, that sounds like pagan is like the bad word. You know, and you're calling yourself a pagan. And so I don't know why I said this. It was not, do not say this, okay, to people. I said, so, like, you know you're going to hell then, right? Like I said, it was a more embarrassing Christian moment. It's not the kind of thing that I would be like, that's how you should start conversations with people or speak in the wider culture, as a general rule. And as soon as the words went out of my mouth, I could just see her face drop and her eyes narrow. And I thought, oh, I've made an enemy for the next several years. And I had. I actually had. She did not like me for a long time. We had lots of classes together. She never wanted to talk to me about anything. There was an opportunity to have a debate in class, she and I would go head to head about everything. I remember thinking at one point, kind of in my senior year, after this had happened for a number of years, I remember thinking to myself, is there any way for me to change her mind? And I don't know. I don't know. I saw her years later, and she pretended that she had never known me, which shows that probably she never changed her mind. There are certain ways that Christian people have an influence on those around them that devastate those around them. It's not intentional sometimes. It's just we're so fervent about what it is that we believe, perhaps, or maybe we have a political viewpoint on something, and that comes out, and the person who is not a Christian doesn't like us for reasons that aren't necessarily biblical. You know, it's not like they don't like us because we presented to them what's true in Scripture and tried to winsomely argue it with them. It's more we were harsh or we were unkind or the way that we lived was not up to the Christian ideals to some degree. There's actually a guy in around 2008, he wrote a book called Unchristian. I had a chance to meet him. His name's Dave Kinneman. And he wrote this book, and he's a sociologist, and he went around talking to different people who were not Christians but had a lot to do with Christians and trying to figure out what are their perceptions of the Christian church. And so what he came to in the end was a series of phrases that non-believers used to describe believers that I don't know if you're a Christian in the room that you would like to be called. So we're hypocritical, according to many unbelievers. We're anti-homosexual. We're sheltered, overly political, and above all things, judgmental. Now look, if you're like me, I immediately want to jump in and be like, okay, wait. Here's why you say that. And there's a whole worldview that you're operating with, and you're making judgments from that worldview. So I want to get into the apologetics of it, right? The arguments for the faith based upon all of that. But they do feel that way, many, because of the influence that Christian people have had on them or the way that they've perceived Christian people to be in the media, or whatever it is. They do feel that way, which is interesting because it's, as I said in the last few weeks, very similar to the way the church was treated in the early centuries. The early church was thought to be incestuous because we had love feasts, right? We took the body and blood of Christ. We had love feasts with our brothers and sisters, which was just a way of talking about how we would get together for dinner and celebrate the Lord's Supper. But people outside were like, what? You're having love feasts with your brothers and sisters? Gross. So in those days, if Dave Kinneman were around and he was doing an interview, they might say, you guys are gross. They said that we were cannibals because we did eat the body and blood of the Lord. They believed we were atheists because we only worshiped one God. And of course, there were people in those days, just like people like me today, who are like, whoa, 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 whoa. You totally misunderstand. There are people in those days who are jumping forward and saying, whoa, 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 whoa. You totally misunderstand. Like, it's okay if you don't like Christians. But don't like them for the right biblical reasons. Like you reject their doctrine or you reject the way that they view the world, whatever, that's fine. But if you're not gonna like Christians, let it be for the right reasons, not the wrong reasons. And unfortunately, we live in a world where lots and lots and lots of people don't like Christians for what I perceive to be the wrong reasons. It's important we don't add fuel, in other words, to the critics' fires unnecessarily. So how do we change people's minds? That's why the guy wrote that book. unchristian. It wasn't just, hey, here's a bunch of people think about you. It was like, okay, so how do you change people's minds from these things to what you actually do? You actually do believe. You can like his solutions or you don't need to like his solutions, but I actually think that 1 Peter is a great spot to look if you want to see what Peter says regarding how you can change the minds of people in your community who have the wrong impression about Christians. You might be surprised at some of the things he has to say, but that's what I want to get into here in the next few minutes. The passage that we're going to be dealing with is basically just controlled by this statement, okay? In 1 Peter 2, verse 12, he says, keep your conduct among the Gentiles, the unbelievers, okay? Keep your conduct among the unbelieving world honorable. Why? Well, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, right? You guys are incestuous, whatever, anti-homosexual, like whatever it is. When they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation, meaning when Jesus returns, they will have enough evidence in front of them that they will have given their lives over to God. So your life, your good deeds can serve an apologetic purpose. It can serve the purpose of actually adorning the gospel for them, showing them that the gospel's true. And so Peter's concerned about this. He's like, look, this is the effect you ought to have on your community, even though they're going to accuse you of being evildoers. How then do we do this? Well, that's what he gets into in this passage. Immediately following these words, he's going to get specific, very specific. So how do we witness well when the world is watching? One, we obey their rules. And two, we suffer differently. So we obey their rules and we suffer differently. This is Peter's argument, okay? So let's deal with the first of those first. We obey their rules. You want to change their minds? Well, let's obey their rules. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13. So the next verse immediately, right? Let your conduct be honorable. How? Number one, be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution. Whether it be the emperor as supreme or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do evil and praise those who do good. Be subject for the Lord's sake to the emperor and to the governors who he sent. You need to know a little bit about the way the Romans understood the Caesar. The Caesar was the king, right? That's what they called him, Caesar Augustus. So the way that the Caesar is viewed is that he was a god. It originally began that he became a god after he died, okay? Which is, I guess, a great thing to have happen to you. But you live your whole life, and then the moment you die, they would enshrine him as one of the gods in the pantheon of gods. But if you want to get ahead of the game and you really want the Caesar to like you, while he's alive, you can start treating him like he's divine. And that's what they would do. They would treat Caesar as if he were the most important, anyway, God in the pantheon at the time. This is very similar, by the way, if you know your Bible, the way that Pharaoh thought of himself, you know, and Moses comes to Pharaoh and says, God says, let my people go. And Pharaoh says, who is this Yahweh? Who is this God that I should believe in him? Or should I should obey him? And that's Pharaoh's way of saying, you're from your God? Well, I'm a God, and I don't listen to other gods when they tell me what to do. This is a very common thing in the ancient world for the ruler to think of themselves as gods, and it happens today as well. No? Okay. Don't live where I do, but okay. Here's the thing. If you're a Christian, though, So you come, you know, you grow up in that society and you become a Christian. The first thing that you do is you have to confess a certain thing, and it is that Jesus is Lord. Yep. Which means that there is only one Lord, and his name is not Caesar. Jesus is Lord, Caesar is not. So if you come to faith in Jesus, and that becomes the thing you're thinking is, okay, Jesus is Lord. I don't need to pay attention to anybody telling me that Caesar is some sort of God. Why don't I just disregard what Caesar says then? Right? I mean, that seems to make sense. I'm going to do what Jesus says, and which is awesome, and I'm also, just as a basic rule, never going to do what Caesar says. Because I don't like him, he's mean, he's a jerk, he thinks too highly of himself, so see you later. Now, Peter's concerned that that kind of attitude will get the Christians in this area on the wrong side. Unnecessarily irritate those who are not Christians. You don't need to treat him like he's a god. You don't have to. Caesar. But don't go too far the other way and say, well, just because Jesus is Lord, Caesar is not, and therefore I'm not going to listen to a single thing that Caesar says. Instead, you're supposed to be subject to him. You place yourself under his authority. Why? Here it is. Not because Caesar's amazing. Right? Because he's going to tell you the reason that you should place yourself underneath my authority, if you were talking to Caesar, is he would say, well, the reason is because I'm amazing and I'm divine. But Peter's like, we know he's not divine, so why should you place yourself under the authority of Caesar? Because it's what the Lord wants you to do. The who? The Lord. The Lord wants you to do. The Lord Jesus Christ wants you to submit yourself to the governing authorities around you. Recognize and respect those rulers for the Lord's sake. This is not the only place in the scriptures where this is said. You get in Romans 13, the Apostle Paul coming along and saying something. It's very similar. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities. Why? For there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. So here's the way that God wants it to work, is that he's God, and he has used these civil authorities to govern us. They're going to answer to God for the way that they act, okay? But the way that God has instituted it is that the civil authorities are appointed by God, whether you like them or not, whether you voted for them or not, they are appointed by God, instituted by him. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. So be subject to the Lord's sake. As soon as I, can I just pause the sermon? Since a lot of you are like, thank you. Okay, just let me pause the sermon for a minute, right? We have to deal with something that is going on in all the heads of my dear American friends in the room, right? Aren't we? All of us are like, I don't like Caesars or kings or governments or anything like that. I'm a libertarian, and I want to go on my farm and have my own land. I have my own flag. I raised it up, and they can come over my dead body. Okay. The reason we say that is because we know that governments stink. And they stink because they end up telling you to do things that God doesn't want you to do. God, listen, government under God, awesome. But not every governor under God recognizes God and acts toward people in appropriate ways. What do we do when wicked commands are given to us by the authority that we're supposed to submit to? Peter. So when the authority says, if you have black skin, you get to drink from that water fountain. And if you have white skin, you get to drink from that water fountain. If you have white skin, you get to sit in this section of the bus. But if you have black skin, you have to sit in this section of the bus. What do we do? And the government says, that's how it's going to work. And we think, hey, what do we do? It's funny that we had this awesome opportunity as a church over the last, not just Harvest, but the church global, actually, to work some of this out in the last number of years with the whole COVID thing, right? This was the issue. It's amazing how few churches actually engaged in talking about it. So now that it's all over, pray, please, Lord, please. Now that it's all over, can we, let's just go back and let's talk for just a minute. We'll talk for just a minute about this issue. When the government tells you to do something that you think or that you can show scripturally is against what God is saying, then how should you act? I had the privilege, actually, of writing a paper about this during the COVID stuff because I was living in Canada. And in Canada, in British Columbia, we were not allowed, under COVID, we were not allowed to sing to God. You can come to church in groups of 50 people and you have to stay a certain distance apart, but you're not allowed to sing to God. So there's whole psalms, just so you know, there are whole psalms that say, sing to the Lord a new song. Did you know that? Did you know that those are what we call imperatives, like commands? But apparently the government says you can't sing to God. Oh, okay. Not in this setting, whatever, you got masks. Even if you had a mask on, you still couldn't sing. You can't show hospitality. Not the biblical kind, where you welcome in the stranger. You're not allowed to do that, says the government. In fact, you'll probably get kicked out of all sorts of things if that happened. And you're certainly not to have human contact. So where it says, where you have examples in scripture about lepers being taken care of and stuff, you can't. Listen, I don't really care about the whole, your viewpoint on the COVID thing, but there were places where the government, where I lived, maybe not here, but where I lived, was saying, yeah, we're going to actually say you can't do some of these things. And for good reasons, right? Health, public safety, and stuff like that. But here, you have to do these things. And so there were a lot of people who came around and said, see, 1 Peter. Do you understand? 1 Peter says governing authorities. You submit to them, be subject to them. It's not hard. It's not unclear. But then the question arises, okay, are there any other examples in Scripture where you have faithful Christian people who are not responding well to the governing authorities when the governing authorities tell them to do something that is less than Christian? And the answer is, you bet. You bet. There's actually quite a few. And so I showed 10, my little paper, I showed 10 places in Scripture where faithful Christians did not bow to the law of the land. Now, I'm not going to give you all 10, but here are a few of them. The Hebrew midwives were told, hey, you need to go by the Pharaoh, you kill all those little Hebrew babies when they're born. And the Hebrew midwives were like, no. But they didn't tell the government that. They were like, we're not going to do that. We're actually going to facilitate their births. And then when the Pharaoh came and said, why are there so many little kids? I thought I told you guys to off the little Hebrew boys. They're like, oh, these women are just so vigorous in their childbirth. They just straight lied, you know, like. But this is a noble act. It's presented as a noble act on their part. So they didn't obey. Queen Vashti in the story of Esther, the king is getting good and drunk in the other room for a week, and he ends up telling his wife, Queen Vashti, come on over into the room with all of my drunk friends and do a little twirl. And she says, no. She pays the price for it, but it's presented actually in the scriptures as Vashti's a good guy, a good girl. She shouldn't have done it in front of all those drunk friends. How about Daniel when he's told he's not supposed to pray in certain ways and he still prays? Wise men, every Christmas we celebrate disobedience to the government. We do. What are the wise men doing? Herod's like, hey, listen, guys, I want to worship that king too. I just don't know where he is. So when you find him, come back and report to me and tell me, and I will go right there. That's the only information they have, is that the king of the land really wants to go and bow his knee and say, hey, cool, a successor. The wise men get there, and they go the other way. They disobey. Praise God. They disobeyed. Peter and John are told by the governing authority of the Sanhedrin, the ruling religious council, stop preaching in his name. And they have a great line. You tell me which is better, to obey you or to obey God. So there's lots of examples in Scripture. Okay, so now we've got a problem because Peter's telling us, hey, submit, be subject to the governing authorities. Peter, you yourself weren't subject to the governing authorities at every single turn, which leads me, of course, to great scholar Tom Schreiner and his commentary on this passage. He says this very well. Peter did not envision Christians submitting to government regardless of the circumstances, even if ruling authorities prescribe what is evil. The ultimate loyalty of Christians is to God, not Caesar. They are liberated from fearing Caesar, and hence they don't feel compelled to do whatever he says. Believers are God's servants first, and thereby they have a criterion by which to assess the dictates of government. Ordinarily, believers will submit to the commands of the ruling authorities. For in the normal course of life, governments punish evil behavior and reward good conduct. The inclination and instinct of believers then will be submission to government. But Peter wanted to avoid anarchy and a kind of enthusiasm that rejects any human structures. Nevertheless, if governments prescribe what is evil or demand that believers refuse to worship God, then believers as slaves of God must refuse to obey. He's right, so I'll put it in a picture because pictures are way better. It's a Venn diagram. You're like thrilled. Okay. All right, so here's my Venn diagram. I want you to see there's three categories. There's one, there's two, and there's three categories. So let's say this is what God commands over here. This is what the government commands over here. God and the gov. All right. There are obviously going to be overlaps between what God and the government say. In some societies, it's this big. In some societies, it's a massive overlap. It just depends on where you live. But wherever these overlap, our inclination is always absolutely we are going to obey as much as we possibly can. But there will be places where the government says do that, where God says do this, and the government says, nah, you shouldn't do that. This is the area, guys, that is going to make us look really weird to our neighbors. Because we end up living by different standards, right? And they look at it and go, well, the law doesn't say that. And we're like, yeah, but killing babies is wicked. But there are places where the government's going to say, do this, and God's going to be like, no. It's in this area here where we are like, look, we want to follow you, oh, great Pritzker, Trudeau, Biden, Trump, like whatever. We want to follow. It's just that you tell us which is better, to follow God or to follow man. So, in the end, we are obligated to do this. And Peter's coming along, and he's essentially saying, look, can we try to make this middle part as big as we possibly can? Why? Because, don't you see, we can change their minds. They think it's tiny. They think it's little and insignificant. We can absolutely change their minds. This is the will of God, he says, that by doing good, you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free. Look, you're free in Christ. You don't You're not bound to the Caesar. He's not a god. He's not going to change. He's not going to ruin you for eternity or anything like that. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom, though, as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. So summary, look, honor everyone. As a general, just honor everyone. Which is a radical thing, right? From Caesar all the way down to everybody else. Honor everyone. Specifically, love the brotherhood. Fear God. Honor the emperor. There are those who think badly of Christians unnecessarily, and their minds can be changed by obeying the rules. So I give you an example, a couple examples, and then we'll move to the second part. You guys saw in the news that the Stop Oil protesters were out at O'Hare Airport a number of weeks ago, and they stopped all the cars from going to the airport. I don't know about you, but I love it when the traffic stops once you're getting on the plane. If you want to get me on your side, stop me before I get on the plane. Well, no, of course not. Of course not. This is a great example, though, of how it is that the wider society can be just irritated by the dumb things that certain parties do to try to push back against the government. There are Christian groups that do this kind of thing, and this is exactly what Peter's after. He's saying, don't do that. You should be known for your obedience to the government. You should be known as people who actually make better citizens than everybody else. So I knew a guy who was a pastor in Laos. And one of the problems in Laos is that it's very illegal to be a Christian in many cases, and certainly to preach Christ. And so he had an opportunity to meet with some of the governing authorities of the country, and he went together with them, and here was his argument. He was like, I don't think you guys, you don't like us for this series of reasons, but you don't understand. First of all, your objections are not grounded well, but what's most important for you to understand is that if everyone in the country were a Christian, you guys would have it way better off as rulers. We make better citizens. Like, we love our neighbors, and when there are poor people around, we try to take care of the poor. We try to honor one another. We treat each other as brothers and sisters, and your problems are the community life that you want, oh, great rulers of Laos, could be had if you let Christianity proliferate. The fact that it's not like that is because you're trying to oppress it. Exactly. That's Peter's argument. We should be the kind of people who make the best citizens around. Not the people who stop everyone on the way to going to Thanksgiving. All right, next one. You guys having fun? No, you're not. You're staring at me like, oh, I can't wait to write that email. I don't care. So 1 Peter 2. 18. Here's the next part then, okay? So two ways, I said. Number one, obey their rules. If you want to, you know, win friends and influence people, if you want to change their minds about the way that Christians act. And the second one is suffer differently. Suffer differently. All right, so here we go. Servants. I have to stop and talk about this word. This work in the original language, which was Greek for this, that he wrote in Greek and it's been translated into English. The Greek word here is a word that means household servant. It's a word that is used for people like doctors or teachers or managers or artisans. But all of those people are slaves in the household sense. So if you go to other translations other than the English standard, which is what we're using here, you will find that the word here is slaves. And that's right. That's right. The word it literally is servants, but it means slaves. So slaves, these household slaves who are in the situation they're in because of a number of things that have gone wrong in their lives, all right? So the reason, here's how it is that you can become a slave in the Roman world. In case you get a time machine and you're just itching to do it. Here, you can get captured in a war. So the city gets captured. You don't want to fight anymore. I give up. You become a slave of the conquering Roman. You can get kidnapped into it, which was common, right? People just show up. The slave traders, they grab you. They sell you. This happened to Joseph. Remember in the Old Testament? Or you're born into it. Every child of a slave, of an actual slave, was born into slavery. They didn't belong to their parents. They belonged to the owner of the owner of the parents. So those are the ways that you became a slave. You could get out of slavery. That was what we call manumission. And manumission could happen if you had enough money to buy your way out, although it wasn't massively frequent. But it could happen. Many slaves were more educated and capable than their owners. Do you follow that? Like, one of the ways you could also become a slave is that you'd sell yourself into it because you can't pay your bills. Les Miserables, I think is. No, maybe not. I can't remember. You can't pay your bills. You owe so-and-so. Instead of going, you know, to the bank and working out payment details, the way it would work is, okay, so you come and work it off, like the dishwasher at the place that you can't afford the lunch. So you become this slave for those people. Now, you can understand how somebody who's a really capable business person but just fell on hard times, maybe really educated, would end up having to go into slavery to some person who's just had, you know, the rub of the green. And so all of a sudden, you get this really capable person working in the house as a household slave for somebody who's kind of a doofus. And this happened a lot. A lot. It wasn't race-based. Please, when I say slavery and we talk about it in the United States, immediately our minds go back to like the slave trade. And that's not the way it worked in those days. It was not kind. Don't get me wrong. It's not like slavery in those days was like, oh, it's such a lovely thing compared to now. It was terrible. The owners could do anything they wanted basically with you. You were their property. Pause the sermon again. Get it over with. Okay, just it won't take long. You know, one of the big questions that people ask oftentimes is, why in the Bible, when you start having words like slave show up, why is it that the next frame is slaves run away as quick as you can and everyone else fight this institution because it's wicked? Which, of course, right? Of course. One of the things you need to understand is actually the Bible does nowhere approve of slavery. It teaches people how to live underneath this particular institution, which is wicked. And there are lots of social institutions that people live under. But the biggest concern that the biblical writers have is actually at the root of the problem of humanity, okay? Because I would say slavery is a fruit of the problem with humanity. The root problem with humanity is that we're sinners. And so the biblical writers are trying to work out, okay, nothing is going to work. We could try, like a tree, if we went to the tree and we tried to fix this diseased tree by just addressing the apples, the next apples that come out are going to be just as diseased, right? We're just going to keep doing this and doing this and doing this and doing this. If we can get to the root of the tree, if we can deal with the question of your relationship with God, then the fruit of the tree will be a result of the root of the tree. And this is where you get so much that's written in the New Testament. It's not that these guys didn't care about the social issues of their day. It's just that they were strategic on how you're going to deal with those issues. Let's deal first with the root issue, your relationship with God, and then social change will be the fruit of that changed life. You know how slavery went away, by the way, yes? The convicted, capable Christian people, William Wilberforce, show up. And they say, as a Christian, I can't see this happening anymore. John Newton, his mentor, former slave trader, we can't have this happen anymore. It's inconsistent with our Christian convictions. Yes. Yes. So, play the sermon again, okay? Okay. I want you to picture in your head, though, that, okay, so this guy who's a really capable, educated, smart person gets into economic difficulty, and he's all of a sudden has to sell himself into slavery. And the owner is now this doofus dude whose dad was really smart or whatever, and he inherited the stuff, and he's just You guys all know people like this, right? You're like, how did that guy get all that money? He got it from his dad. Okay, so now that guy's the owner and the other guy's the slave, but this other guy who's the slave becomes a Christian. And you know what Christians say? We say stuff like, you're free in Christ. It's neither no slave nor free, male nor female. All are one in Christ Jesus. So all of a sudden he's like, I don't need to listen to this slave owner. I don't need to listen to this dumb master who thinks he knows all these things. And not only that, he's harsh and he's wicked and he's over. I'm okay following the dictates of a master who's nice, but when the master's a jerk. I mean, he's not asking me to do anything wicked or sin, but I just don't like him. So as a Christian, I'm free. I'm out of here. I don't need to listen to you anymore. Peter's concerned about this. So servants, household workers, Christian brothers who are in this particular state, be subject to your masters with all respect. And I'm not saying not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. This word here is the Greek word skolios. Does it sound like? Scoliosis, right? It means crooked. Also to the crooked. Not when they're asking you to do something wicked, but if they're people you don't like, doesn't matter. Still do it. Why? For this is a gracious thing. This is something that God favors. When mindful of God, right, for the Lord's sake, when you recognize that this is what God wants you to do, mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a favorable thing in God's eyes. For to this you've been called, this kind of life, this kind of submission sort of life, because Christ, why? Because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you, here it is, an example so that you might follow in his steps. Okay, wait a minute, what did Christ, so I'm supposed to be subject to my stinky owner. Why? Well, because Christ was subject to a bunch of people he could have blinked out of existence. He committed no sin, Jesus. Neither was deceit found in his mouth. Jesus goes up to this trial, this monkey trial that they put on, and they bring a whole bunch of people forward who are all a bunch of liars talking about he did this, he did this, he did this. Not once did Jesus stand up in the middle of the trial and go, that's it, your mouth is gone. See that tongue? It's my hand. He doesn't do this. And the Lord our God, he could do that. Ananias and Sapphira just cack it right on the spot. Jesus could have been just like, I'm so tired, done. He didn't lie in return. They lied, he didn't lie. When he was reviled, remember he goes out and he is mocked by the soldiers. Hail, King of the Jews, poo, 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 whip, whip, whip. He didn't revile in return. You think that he could have reviled in return? I mean, the God of the locusts could have reviled in return. Can you imagine? Locusts! When he suffered, he didn't threaten. If you guys don't stop this right now, I am going to undo all of your history and all of the history of your family and all of the history. No one will have ever existed, especially you. He didn't threaten, but he continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, by the fact that he went through all of these things and wounds were inflicted upon him and he welcomed them without spitting venom in return, you have been healed. Healing comes from suffering, from the willingness to take it on and remain silent. Healing came from that. You were straying like sheep, but now you've returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. So here's his point, okay? Noble suffering, instead of vengeful payback, lead to ultimate healing. Now, I have to make a clarification as we finish this out, all right? You're not slaves. I know, crazy. There are a lot of people who come to this passage right now and say, okay, so now in your workplace, when your boss is a jerk, do everything he says. Okay. We're not slaves. If you're in your workplace and your boss is a jerk, you should find a new workplace. Amen? Amen. You don't need to do that. So this applied directly to a workplace is crazy. So what does it apply to? Well, I think it applies to any situation where you're facing injustice that you just can't do anything about. You're tempted to do something about it, though. You know, to reply with vengeance. This is about the apologetic power of suffering well under injustice. Noble suffering instead of vengeful payback leads to ultimate healing. All right, here's some examples. I've had lots of experiences in my life where I've gotten very upset in the car, as have you. I do remember one occasion when I was driving with my family back from the eastern side of the mountains in British Columbia, and the mountains there are like legit mountains. There's a place called the Coquihalla Highway, which is one of the most dangerous roads in the world. And we came across it, and it was terrible. It was raining, as it always did, and it was awful. You could barely see it from the grip in the steering wheel the whole time, and people trying to cut you off all the time. So irritating. Finally, you come out of the Coquihalla Highway, you eventually come down on this flat area where finally it calms down. You're almost home. We've driven for 4 hours in this. You know, everybody lines up in the left lane because we all want to pass the trucks. And then there's always that person who's like, I'm going to go around on the right to the back of the truck and then cut everyone off. Yeah? Yeah? I don't see you guys nodding. It must be you. It's probably you who does this, right? So anyway, I've been driving for I don't know how many hours. And so all of a sudden, I'm driving, and all of a sudden this lady, she got a dog on her lap, a little tiny dog on her lap. She's eating her chips and like gunning it. And I'm like, no, not today. So I sped up. You know, they come up. I sped up, and I slowed right down by the truck. And she's freaking out, like, how could you possibly do this? And so then I'm like, okay, it's on now. So I slowed down, and I stayed next to that two-lane highway. I stayed next to that truck. She's trying to go behind me and then on the side of me and stuff, and I'm just kind of meandering over here. My wife's like, what are you doing? We're all gonna die. And I'm like, justice is what I'm doing, okay? I went in front of that truck, and then she pulls it to the right, and I gunned it up to the next truck, and then slowed down. Man, I was doing this for a good 10 minutes or whatever. I've never seen somebody so angry in my life. Her head was about to pop. The dog was barking like crazy. I was having a great time, right? She was telling me I was number one a lot, and I was waving back to her and, you know, blowing her kisses and stuff like this, and my wife is freaking out. Kids are asleep in the back, and she's, why are you doing this? We're all gonna die. Okay, you've done this. Why do I do this? Why? And the answer is because there's something deep inside of me that says this is an injustice. She should not be acting this way, and it's my job to fix it. Now, whether it's my job to fix it or not doesn't matter, but it's this driving force in my heart that says injustice shouldn't happen around them. And I feel like if I don't fight that injustice, it's gonna get done. That injustice will conquer, and it will be left for everyone to see that there's no one who's willing to do anything about injustice. The bullies will win. But there's a better way. Romans 12, 17. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Let her in, right? Beloved, never avenge yourselves, It doesn't stop here. Do you know that? This passage doesn't stop here. Never avenge yourselves. Isn't that neat? But leave it to what? The wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the reason that you're able to turn away from injustice and stuff that can't, that drives you crazy and you can't do anything about except just pray. The reason you as a Christian are able to do that is because you can say, I'm putting it in your hands, Lord. This is wrong. This is wrong. I don't need to get vengeance. I don't need to fight back. And when you choose to go this way, the aroma of Christ that spreads around the world is something that so many people just don't know what to do with. It's so beautiful. The peace of Christians acting in the midst of suffering peacefully when they should be fighting is an apologetic tool that we don't use, but has so much power according to Peter. So you work in a workplace and your boss is a jerk and you say, okay, I'm not a slave, I'm going to leave. But now when you leave, you get to have an opportunity to do one of two things. You can light your match, right? Throw diesel on the whole place, light it up. You can go on Facebook and all the stuff about how wicked and terrible these people are and how horrible they are. Or you can leave professionally, graciously, and say, Lord, I leave it into the hands of the one who says, it is mine to repay. You can be slandered publicly and desperately want to reply. How dare they say that? I'm going to get a burner account, and I'm going to have 50 burner accounts, and I'm going to talk back to this person and like I'm his neighbor. And I'm just going to give it to him. In my full-time job, you can absolutely do this. You can. That's what the whole world does, guys. That's what everybody does. You can act like I did when I was in the car, right? When it comes to responding to slander. Or you could have no deceit found in your mouth. Even though you're suffering unjustly, you can leave it in the hands of the one who judges justly. And you can entrust yourself to him. So last thing, John Stott, he's an old scholar. He wrote a little paper about one of the great Christian martyrs ever. And I'm reading you this Christian martyr story simply because Polycarp's influence in the early church was so powerful. There are so many people who came to faith in Christ because this man was willing to go through what he did. Here's what he did. It was February 2nd, probably AD 156, and the venerable bishop who had fled from the city at the pleading of his congregation was tracked down to his hiding place. He made no attempt to flee. Instead, he offered food and drink to his captors and asked permission to retire for prayer, which he did for 2 hours. Then, as they traveled into the city, the officer in charge urged him to recant. He said, "What harm can it do?" he asked, "to sacrifice to the emperor." Polycarp refused. On arrival, he was roughly pushed out of the carriage and brought before the proconsul in the amphitheater, who addressed him, "Respect your years. Swear by the genius of Caesar." And again, "Swear and I'll release you. Just revile Christ." To which Polycarp replied, "For 86 years I've served him, and he's done me no wrong. How then can I blaspheme the king who saved me?" The proconsul persisted, "Swear by the genius of Caesar. I have wild beasts. If you don't change your mind, I'll throw you to them." "Call them," Polycarp replied. "Since you make light of the beasts, I'll have you destroyed by fire unless you change your attitude." Angry Jews and Gentiles gathered wood for the pile. Polycarp stood by the stake, asking not to be fastened to it. "Oh, I'll stay right here. You don't need to tie me to it." And then he prayed the final words that came out of his mouth. "O Lord, Almighty God, the Father of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, through whom we have come to know you,
I thank you for counting me worthy this day, an hour of sharing the cup of Christ among the number of your martyrs. The fire was lit, but as the wind drove the flames away from him and prolonged his suffering, a soldier put an end to his misery with a sword. He entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. And the world was changed. May it be again. Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for passages like this. They have all sorts of thorny challenges all around them. And I pray you found me faithful in dealing with some of those. But I also, Father, pray that the big push, at least here at the end of this passage, would be one that strikes deep. We are fighting folk, all of us. We desperately want our names to be defended. We want to be seen right and just and honored in our societies like everybody else in the world. And we are wronged so many times. But I pray, Father, I pray that you would help us in those key moments, that you would help us to trust you, like our Jesus did, that we would trust you and give ourselves over to you, the one who judges justly. It is yours to repay. So we leave them to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Church, stand. Sing this one.
The perfect Son of God, in all his innocence, here walking in the dirt with you and me. He knows what living is, he's acquainted with our grief. A man of sorrow, son of suffering, oh, blood and tears. How can it be? There's a God who weeps. There's a God who pleads. Oh, praise the one who reads for me. Hallelujah to the Son of Son. Artist and enemy, but you chased us down in merciful pursuit.
That's right.
To the sinner you were grace, and the broken you embrace. But in the end, the proof is in yours. In the end, the proof is in yours.
Come on.
Your blood still speaking, your love.
You know it's true. Yeah.
We see your cross, my freedom, your stripes, my healing, all praise, King.
Glory to God. There's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Hallelujah to the Son of suffering. Say hallelujah to the Son of suffering. Sing that over. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Son of suffering.
Still speaking, and his love is still reaching into the darkest places of our hearts and pulling us out. His love is endless for you, for me. We are loved, Harvest. Yeah. By an awesome God. The God of the universe loves us so much. And that's why we say you are loved at the end of each service. We are loved. And we love our mothers. And so we are so grateful for our moms. And, moms, we have a special gift for you in the lobby. So don't leave without taking your gift. We have some flowers in the lobby next to the photo area. Please grab a flower as you leave today. And if I haven't had an opportunity to meet you, I would love to do that. I'll be in that area. And as we go out on mission this week for the Lord, remember that Jesus loves you, he's with you, he sees you, and he's still speaking in your lives every day. All right? You are loved.